One of the cool things about software-defined radar is that we can continuously update the algorithms over the lifetime of the product.
Welcome to Talking Autonomy. This episode's all about radar, or I should say software-defined radar. I'd like to introduce you to Tegan, who's joining us today, who leads our Radar Center of Excellence in Dallas, Texas. Tegan, tell us a little bit about yourself and what you and the folks down in Dallas do for Ghost.
Yeah, so I'm a radar systems engineer and with double E degree, and I spent the last 15 years before Ghost in the defense industry, mostly making missile seekers for radars. And Ghost opened the Radar Center of Excellence in Dallas because of the strong talent base for radar engineers in that area, again, from the defense background. So we brought together some engineers from there, some engineers who had experience in the autonomy space, and we stood up a radar team whose goal is to make the next generation radar to support Ghost.
It must be super confusing for, you know, 15 years of your life working on radar and trying to seek things out, and now you're trying to kind of avoid them. But other than that, give us a sense for, you know, kind of how the skills of you know, military radar translate over to the auto world.
Yeah, there's a couple important things. The first one is interference mitigation. In a defense radar, you're expecting that your adversary is going to send out some jamming signal, and you're going to be in a very cluttered electromagnetic environment. In autonomy, although nobody's malicious, the environment is still very cluttered. More and more cars are equipped with radars, and those radars all provide signals that are interfering with the one that we're trying to send out and receive. That interference can lead to false alarms or misdetections. The second thing we bring from defense is multifunction radar. Multifunction radar is constantly changing the mode that it's operating in based on what it senses in the environment and what the system needs it to do. If we didn't have a multi-mode system, we would have either had to build hardware that was excellent across all dimensions, and that would be too expensive, or you would do what people do today, and that's they build hardware that is modest across all dimensions. But with multifunction, we can take that same hardware and employ it differently over time. And this time, when I say over time, I can mean even over millisecond intervals. We can be changing what we're doing in the hundreds of milliseconds. So we can go from a high dynamic range mode or a long range mode. We can do different things with our PRFs. Going back to interference mitigation, we can be constantly sensing and adjusting to the environment. So those are some of the things you can do with a multi-mode radar.
You know, one of the key elements of our design is that the radar is software-defined. So break that down for us. What does it mean to be a software-defined radar?
That's right. So when you're a software-defined radar, what that means is that you are actually passing back the raw signal that comes off of the A to D converters, and you're passing that back into a software stack that you can change over time. Okay? Whereas in a traditional setup, what you would do is you would have your signal processing living right up next to those A to D converters. You may have an FPGA or a custom ASIC sitting right behind it. You would take in those signals, you'd process them down to a much smaller volume, then you'd put that on a low bandwidth data pipe and send that to the back. Okay? Now, what we're talking about is actually sending that higher bandwidth data from the radar front end back to the signal processing. We can do that with commercially available technology, so it does not drive our price up, and it gives us this tremendous flexibility of having all of our algorithms in our centralized compute. So first of all, that's a cheaper environment to have a processing resource live in, so it helps you control cost. It helps you with flexibility, because now I can be constantly evolving my algos in real time, shoulder to shoulder, next to the system engineers who are working one level above us. So that's where that interaction and ability to dynamically change your data product to suit the system need comes to play.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds amazing. And I'm struck by the parallels with our vision system. You know, I think we figured out early on that if we could just have raw camera feeds sending data back to the central processor and use neural networks to have all the information, we could do much more with it. And we're essentially now taking the same approach with radar, where we're trying to get as much information as possible centrally so we can analyze it to the full abilities.
Yeah, that's absolutely right.
Well, I mean, I feel like in general, it's a bit of a renaissance time right now for radar. A lot of people are excited about it, and I think that stems from kind of a belief that we can really elevate radar to be a primary sensor. You know, a lot of the earlier deployments of radar in autos kind of used it with a camera, and you really kind of needed to have a camera to find an object to be able to cut through the noise of the radar to say, this is an object, okay, now tell me its distance. But I think with some of these new techniques, we can really elevate radar to a primary sensor that's kind of a peer with a camera. I have that about right?
Yeah, that's right. So it's understood that if you use basic algorithms and basic detection techniques, you're going to have too many false alarms. This is expected, if you will, and which is why camera confirmation is important. But it's not actually a limitation of radar. Radar itself is capable of providing a clean enough signal, but it requires a different way to do the hardware, and most importantly, a different way to do the algorithms. Those techniques are all born and proven in the defense world. We'll bring those techniques to where we are now, and now we'll get a clean signal, a signal that the autonomy system can use, can trust, that is not laden with false alarms or misdetections.
So one of the topics you brought up in your intro was about multi-mode and how we're developing the radar in a way that we can, you know, in real time, change how it's behaving and maybe change where it focuses. Say more about that. That sounds really cool.
Yeah, so when we do this, we have the ability to decide which dimension we're going to maximize at that point in time. What are the dimensions? Like angle accuracy, range, dynamic range, interference mitigation, et cetera. So by interacting with the system, and by us sensing and probing on the environment, we can choose to maximize differently at different points in time. So it's going to be constantly switching between modes as it goes, and that's going to allow us to give the performance in the wide range of environments without having to expand the cost. And that's why it's a big deal for us.
So like if I'm driving down the highway, if we're going, you know, 60 miles an hour down the freeway versus in stop and go traffic, we might change the mode?
Yeah, I would expect you to be in definitely a different mode between those two situations for sure.
Yeah.
Right? You'll see the density in the traffic will change. Like how will you know to change, right? It's the behavior of your car, the behavior of the environment around you. And you'll use those two factors to decide what mode you need to be in.
Wow, I'm really getting a sense for the intelligence that software defined can bring. It also allows us to configure the radar differently for a forward application versus, say, a rear or a side application as well, right?
Absolutely. You have different physics and different kinematics, so you'll tune them in different ways. And even forward and side, they'll each be doing their own thing separately that's optimized for the mission they're trying to accomplish at that moment. So that's why each of the different radars can operate in different modes, and we'll make sure we don't have any mutual interference between all the ones that are on our cars.
You know, one of the things that people are often surprised about is that we dove in and decided to build our own radar. So why take on that ambitious project versus just, you know, taking one of the off-the-shelf radars that are on the market today?
Yeah, we actually evaluated a lot of off-the-shelf radars to see if we could make that work, but they all had the same limitations. They produced data products that were not based on what the system needs. There's a radar company building a radar, and they hope that one day an autonomy company will pick it up and do something with it. But it doesn't allow that interaction. It doesn't allow that evolving of the requirements between the system and the subsystem. The other limitation that we found when we were looking at these off-the-shelf radars is they had their onboard signal processing very difficult for us to get in there and change it. We knew fundamentally we had to go change the way the signal processing worked.
Right, we wanted to be able to tune it and really customize it
for
our needs.
And that was just not going to be possible with those off-the-shelf radars.
So I think one of the most amazing things about this design is the hardware, as I understand it, is just really nothing special, and all the magic's in the software. So how were you able to achieve these, interesting outcomes using pretty off-the-shelf, you know, hardware?
That's right. We'll often hear people say, like, well, you can't get level 4 with this. This is a level 2 part. Well, what does that really mean, right? It's more about how you use the parts. So what we have are core TX-RX chips that are existing, and they are widely available in the market. And what we've done is we've put a different antenna topology in front of them. We have different calibration techniques. We have different algorithmic approaches. And we bring all those things together, and that's what actually unlocks the performance. There is not a need to go to a very expensive or a very custom solution to the front end, because those aren't actually going to solve the problems that you have, especially in the domain of interference. You can't just throw hardware or money at the problem. You actually have to have that smarts in your software and your algorithms.
So add it all up for me. I mean, what are the dimensions by which this performs differently or better now?
Yep. So you're talking about better angle accuracy. You're talking about better dynamic range, especially in the angle dimension. And then, again, most importantly, you're talking about signal interference rejection ratios, which are tens of dBs better than what you're seeing in these typical radars.
All right. I know another big area that you guys focus a lot on is calibration. Why is calibration so important for radar? How have you done that?
Yep, that's right. So what calibration allows you to do is sense features in the environment more finely. So now, whereas a typical system, maybe it can only see things that are maybe within 5 dB of one another, or if you want to talk about spatially, maybe they're within just, you know, a few tenths of a degree of each other. Well, with better calibration, now we can separate those things to an even finer and finer degree. Again, this comes into play for interference mitigation. We can sense something in the environment, and we can very quickly know if that is interference from another vehicle, or if that's a true return from another vehicle. Calibration is what leads to performance, but calibration can also be very cost prohibitive. If each radar has to spend hours or days in a calibration environment, and then you put it on a car, and it very delicately falls away from that calibration, then it's not going to be cost effective. So what we've done from the beginning is architected our calibration techniques so that they will be fast to run in a production environment, they'll be stable once they go on the car, and we'll be constantly doing online calibration assessments and adjustments using the radar and the camera and the rest of the system so that our system will stay stable versus time.
That's really cool. I mean, not only can we update the software and improve the capabilities over time, but you have this ongoing calibration that makes sure the device can last in a car for, you know, a decade-long deployment or more.
That's absolutely what it has to have. All the sensors talking together, feeding that information back, we'll actually see as the cars are deployed, we'll get that information back here at Ghost, and we can look for then patterns. Patterns across cars, patterns across lots, across radars, like all those things, all that data that we have access to is how you make a smarter radar system.
Well, Tegan, that sounds amazing. Thanks for leading this ambitious program for us. You know, a new approach to a software-defined radar where we take all the intelligence, bring it centrally, and allow our engineers to build functions that take advantage of radar and vision together to have the best capabilities to power our driving pipeline.
Thank you.